This is the new 2022 Volkswagen Golf R, and it's the latest version of VW's high-performance hatchback. The new Golf R has a lot of improvements over the old one, including more power and other upgrades to the driving experience, and today I'm going to review it. Before I get started, be sure to check out Cars and Bids, which is my enthusiast car auction website for cool cars from the modern era, now with free listings. You can list your car for free and auction it on Cars and Bids. And you should sell your car on Cars and Bids because we keep having great sales, including this Mitsubishi Delica van, which sold for just under $19,000 with four-wheel drive, this fantastic Mercedes E63 AMG wagon, which brought just over $50,000, and this wonderful Audi R8 with a gated six-speed manual that sold for $72,000. If you're looking to buy or sell your cool enthusiast car from the modern era, Cars and Bids is the place to do it, with free listings and a great selection of daily auctions at carsandbids.com. So let's talk Golf R. The old one was great, but with only 290 horsepower, it was starting to fall behind a little bit in the hot hatchback world, so this new one has 315 horses, which leapfrogs it ahead of the Honda Civic Type R. Like the old Golf R, this comes standard with all-wheel drive, and it offers a choice between a manual or a dual-clutch automatic transmission. And there's more that's new about the latest Golf R than just more power. Suspension is revised for better handling, and the styling is new too to match the latest Volkswagen Golf, although it's more evolution than revolution. Of course, technology is also much improved as well. And today, I'm going to review the Golf R and show you everything. First, I'll take you on a thorough tour and show you all the quirks and features of Volkswagen's newest hot hatchback. Then I'll get it out on the road and drive it, and then I'll give it a DOUGSCORE. All right, I'm gonna start the quirks and features of the new Golf R with getting in, and that means starting with the key, which is this cool black shiny thing. Doesn't even have traditional buttons on it, looks very futuristic. And when you turn it over, you can see the R logo, which has been revised for this car. I like this logo, very subtle, which fits in with the Golf R in general. This car has always been about subtlety, performance, hot hatchback, but blending in a little more. And you can see that in the design of this model. Still very restrained, not showy, not shouty like the Honda Civic Type R, with its crazy wings and inlets and scoops and intakes everywhere they could have stuck one. Looks ridiculous. The Golf R, a lot more restrained performance. For a good example of that, just take a look at the rear end. You can see the VW badge and then R. That's it. No craziness back here, no aggressive overstyling. Very simple and subtle, just like the Golf R has always been. But anyway, next up, you climb inside the Golf R, where there's a surprising amount of quirks and features, starting with the seats, which have cloth carbon fiber. This piece here looks like carbon fiber, but it's actually cloth or leather or vinyl, whatever. The point is, it's made to look like carbon fiber. Instead of carbon fiber trim on your dashboard or your steering wheel, you have it on your seats in like a cloth or leather material. Really strange. Also weird about the seats, they have little blue accents because blue is sort of the Golf R's special color, but then they have like a large blue accent, but only on the back top half side of the seat. That's the only spot you have this larger amount of blue, which is a strange placement. And it's even weirder in the back seats. The rear seats also have a blue patch, but only on the headrests. You can see here, not actually on the seats themselves. It's so strange. It's like they wanted to do some bluing of the seats, but not really all that much. And next up, another rather unusual touch in this interior is the gear selector, which is this short, stubby little thing like new Porsches have. You pull it down for drive, drive, you push it up for reverse, and it's this weird little thing sticking out of the center console. If you want to go into park, you press this P button at the top of everything, and that's how all this works. Now, obviously, this Golf R is equipped with a dual-clutch automatic transmission, but a manual will be available, and interestingly, only available in North America. European Golf R models will only be offered with the automatic, but demand has been strong enough in North America for a manual that we're going to get it here exclusively. Now, one other interesting item in this area is the engine start-stop button, which is this. A silver rectangle, which is kind of cold and off-putting and not very fun. Not like some red circle you press to get started. This just looks like any other button, but that's kind of typical of the Golf R. This car has always been known for having a more subtle, more grown-up interior than other high-performance hatchbacks, and that's still true here. You look around this interior and you can see it's just more adult, more legitimate, more sort of luxury car, rather than boy racer fun thing with little plaques and bright colors everywhere. With that said, I have to say, looking around this interior, I'm a little bit disappointed with some of the materials choices in here. There's some cheap plastic as you look around. The top of the dashboard has this cheap looking plastic, not all that classy. Same deal with the door panels. You can see some cheap plastic in here as well. And in the center console area, in particular on the cup holders, kind of cheap looking. This isn't a huge deal in a Golf, but this one has a sticker price of around $45,000. That's big money, and so it's a little disappointing to see them skimping on some of the materials in here. By the way, another disappointing cost-cutting measure up here, the driver's seat in front is power operated. The passenger seat is manually operated. This is a piece of cost-cutting that Volkswagen has been doing for years. Everybody else has abandoned it, but Volkswagen's still doing it. And frankly, it's kind of pathetic at this price point. But anyway, even though this is sort of the grown-up high-performance hatchback, there are still some interesting novelties in this interior. For example, there's a button on the steering wheel marked R. If you press that, the car instantly goes into race mode, which firms up the suspension to an insane degree, and that's not even the craziest or most exciting mode this car offers. There is also a drift mode, which is a pretty cool feature. The Golf R previously had a front limited slip differential. This adds one in back too, and the two can work together and transfer all the power to one side of the car or the other. This is called torque vectoring, and it also facilitates a drift mode. You can literally transfer 100% of the power to one side of the car to make drifting easier, hence the new drift mode, which is kind of interesting. In this area, you will also see another mode selection for Nürburgring mode. If you go into that, it's like a Sport Plus, and everything gets louder and tighter, and the transmission tightens up, and throttle response is quicker, and that's sort of your ultimate track mode in the Golf R. So several different high-performance drive modes here, including a drift mode, even though this is the grown-up hot hatch. But anyway, since I'm already showing you this center screen, let's talk about it. This is a new infotainment system for the Golf R, a new 10-inch center screen, and it has some unusual quirks. For one thing, there's a little panel below the screen that's like touch-sensitive buttons. In the center, you slide your finger to the left or right to control stereo volume, and on the sides, you can adjust climate control, the left side for the driver and the right side, of course, for the passenger, all with this touch-sensitive panel here. Now, interestingly, this panel is not lit at night. So center controls in most cars are lit up at night, but not here as you can see. But that doesn't really matter all that much. It's pretty intuitive, and there are only those few functions on this panel. As for the infotainment system itself, it's a bit of a mixed bag. I've heard some criticisms of this system, and I have to say it takes a little bit more of a learning curve and devoting some more time to it in order to really figure out how it works. But once you do that, it is fairly intuitive, fairly responsive, and it works reasonably like you'd expect it to. Although there's one disappointing exception, and that would be climate controls. In order to change anything with the climate controls except the air temperature, you gotta pull up the climate control screen, as you can see here, and that takes up the whole screen. So if you were looking at a navigation destination or your radio and you want to change the climate settings, well, too bad, now your screen is all climate controls. And annoyingly, this even applies to heated seats. You just want to turn on your heated seats, you gotta pull up the climate menu, block whatever else is on the screen, just just to turn on the heated seats. It'd be so much easier if they were just a simple button like most other cars have. And frankly, that's the danger of incorporating all your climate controls into the screen, especially a screen as small as this one. It's just a little disappointing to use. Fortunately, your defoggers and defrosters are physical buttons. To the left of the steering wheel, you can see them here, so they're pretty easy. You can just tap them if you need to emergency defog. You don't have to go into some screen menu. Now, with that said, even though the center screen is, I would say, only okay as an infotainment system, I love the gauge cluster screen. This is standard on all Golf R's, and it is fantastic. For one thing, you can adjust the view to prioritize various different things depending on what you want to see large or small in your screen, and you can even have a large map in that gauge cluster screen, which is a pretty cool touch. Very configurable, very easy to kind of change depending on what you want. And there's some weird quirks to this. For instance, when you have the screen divided into thirds, you can have the left side of the screen and the right side showing exactly the same thing. If for some reason you want to do that. Most automakers don't allow that, but in the Volkswagen, it's so configurable, you could have that if that's what you want to see. And there are some rather quirky things that you can stick in these display areas. For example, you can make your fuel gauge larger. Even though it's right there, you can also put it there. And then you have two fuel gauges a couple inches apart, which is rather strange, but so configurable, that's an option that you have. Now, adjusting this gauge cluster screen is all done on the steering wheel, which has a few interesting controls of its own. For example, the next track button is over on the right side, and it's not a button at all, it's a slider. You slide your finger over it, and that changes your track backward or forward. Same deal with volume over on the other side of the steering wheel. You just slide your finger, and that adjusts the volume, just like the volume slider in the center. No more knobs for volume or little buttons you press up or down. It's all sliders in this car. And indeed, sliders have been incorporated elsewhere too. For example, the sunroof control. Take a look. You want to open the sunroof, you just swipe your finger back over this control, and then it opens up, which is very interesting. No physical button to press. Instead, you swipe over a panel. And by the way, one rather unusual and very Volkswagen distinctive item with the sunroof, you can open the sunroof but keep the sunshade closed. This cloth sunshade will stay closed even if the sunroof is open, which I guess some people might like. But anyway, next up we move on to the back seat in the Golf R, and rear seat room is about like you'd expect. It's pretty tight back here, which is normal for a compact hatchback, but adults can get back here. Some taller adults will be a little tight, but they can fit, and it's relatively decent size. And you have some nice amenities back here. For instance, heated seats, which you can turn on with this little touchpad in the center behind the front center console, and you also have a temperature control here, as you can see, and you can adjust your rear climate control, which is unusual for a compact hatchback. Now, below that stuff, you also have a nice amenity, which is USB ports, USB-C to be specific, and two of them, one for each side rear passenger. And there's another cool touch back here, storage behind the front seat. You have your little normal storage pocket like most cars have, but then there's a second row of storage above that, and it's split into two parts, pretty well sized for a smartphone, which is kind of cool, adding additional storage for the rear passengers. Next up, nothing else to say about the back seat really, except I'm especially disappointed with the materials that Volkswagen chose to use back here. Volkswagen cost-cutted the rear seat even more than they did up front, and that's particularly noticeable on the door panel. You can see in front, the top part has sort of a padded plastic surface, and then there's this carbon fiber trim. In the rear, you can see it's all just cheap plastic back here. They took out that padded trim, they took out the carbon fiber, and replaced it with a much cheaper looking and feeling plastic, which is just disappointing. It probably saved them only a few dollars per car, and yet that's what they did. Such a cynical cost-cutting move, especially in a hot hatchback where you'll probably be buying it because you want to use the back seat. And next up, we move on to the back of the Golf R, where I want to start with the very coolest tailgate handle in the entire car industry. That's because it's the Volkswagen logo. You walk up, you don't see a tailgate handle, handle. Instead, it's integrated into the logo. You press the top of it, the bottom comes out, and you lift up and open the tailgate from there. Take another look at that using the Volkswagen logo as the tailgate handle, a brilliant piece of design. And that's also the backup camera. When you put this car into reverse, the handle pops out, the backup camera is in the bottom part, and that's how you see behind it. You stick it back in drive, and the tailgate handle pops back into its normal position. But anyway, opening up the tailgate and getting back here, you can see nothing really unusual, but you have a decent sized cargo area. This is your hatchback component of the hot hatchback. It's relatively roomy back here, and of course, the rear seats fold down in case you want even more space. This can become a pretty practical car. But anyway, other items worth noting in back. For one thing, the giant rear spoiler. You can see it here over the rear window, and it is quite large, which helps distinguish the Golf R from the GTI or other Golf models, this big spoiler back here. Also distinctive to the Golf R is quad exhaust. You can see four pipes back here, the universal sign of a true performance car. And frankly, this sounds pretty good for a little four-cylinder. Take a listen. Next, an interesting item worth discussing is side badging. You can see the side of the taillights say Golf, to remind you that's what this is, and on the side of the car between front and rear windows, Volkswagen, to remind you that's what this is also. And by the way, speaking of lighting, coming up to the front of the car, a couple interesting things with the lighting. For one, this blue strip that goes through the headlights and across the entire front of the car, which is kind of a cool tie-in since that blue is the Golf R's special color. Also worth noting, there is a light strip that also goes across the entire front of the car. When you turn on the headlights, of course, they turn on, but this light strip also turns on in front, so you have a front light bar in the Golf R, which is becoming more and more common on new cars. By the way, speaking of that blue strip going across the front end, I must say I also love the blue painted brake calipers, which look fantastic. These little subtle hints of Golf R blue really help to add to the look of the car on the outside. And finally, we move under the hood. You can see the engine. The outgoing Golf R had a 2-liter turbo four-cylinder, and this new Golf R also has a 2-liter turbo four-cylinder, but power and torque have been boosted. The old one had about 290 horsepower, this has 315, and the old one had about 280 pound-feet of torque, and this one has 310, so numbers are a little stronger. 0 to 60 is predicted to come in the low 4-second range, which is pretty good for a little hatchback that no one will ever suspect of being fast until they're getting passed by it. All right, time to drive the new Golf R. First thing I'm going to start with is an acceleration run, which is great. This car is quick. Quick transmission too, and seamless shifts. Pooh, you barely feel it. Just fires off. That is excellent. Really, really quick. Especially for a car like this, hot hatchbacks have become quite fast. This one is exceptionally so. It really feels and is fast. With that said, there is a little bit of hesitancy when you first go to floor it. It takes just a second, there it goes, and kind of rockets you forward. But once the rocket has started, it goes and it is quick. Handling, next thing, is also fantastic. Just like acceleration, handling is great. It's been too long since I've driven the old Golf R for me to really remember exactly how that handled, but this feels great. It feels really, really poised, super well balanced, very difficult to get it unsettled, and makes you feel kind of like a superhero when you're going through corners. Surprisingly so, again, for a hot hatchback. The old one was also really good. I remember it being really good. So I don't know if dramatically how much better this one is. Maybe that's one of those things where you'd have to go to a racetrack to really figure it out. But it feels great around corners. The steering feel is excellent, nice, precise, tight. So from a driving perspective, this car is fantastic. But there are some interesting drawbacks. One is definitely the feel of this car. This has more Volkswagen Golf than I remember, frankly. I showed you some of the cost-cutting things before. Volkswagen has always done a bunch of cynical cost-cutting stuff. This car is full of them. I mean, you can see some plastic in places it shouldn't be, the manual passenger seat when you have a power driver seat, things like that. A little disappointing, but also the driving experience. You can feel, you can hear more road noise, tire noise, etc., than you might think. maybe I should expect that since this is ultimately a Golf, but it's a $45,000 Golf. And for a lot of people, this is kind of a dream car. You know, they worked up from a cheap car, whatever, to a GTI, and now they can get a Golf R. I wish it felt a little bit more special in terms of materials and in terms of noise, suspension harshness, that sort of thing. With that said, you know, it's hard to argue against this car from any reasonable point of view. The Golf R had an interesting thing happen to it since I reviewed the old one, which is its main competitor, its best competitor, was canceled, the Focus RS. I preferred that the most of all the hot hatchbacks, and a lot of people did. It was an amazing car, excellent performance, great precision, but it was canceled. And that's a rare thing to have happen when your top competitor is canceled. Usually a car in the best position in the market, the automaker keeps refining it and refreshing it and to keep it there. But because the regular Focus went away, the Focus RS did too. And that puts the Golf R in sort of a unique spot here. The Civic Type R is a great car, but it is not a rational choice for most people. It looks ridiculous. The stupidest looking car on the road, unquestionably. And also the interior is not really all that great. The performance is there, but it's nice to have all-wheel drive in this car. And the Golf R has always been sort of a more adult, grown-up choice compared to the Civic Type R. And I think that makes sense because that's what this segment is about. You want to, you're growing up from your sports car, your Mustang, and moving on to something that maybe is family friendly. And this provides you with some of those thrills, but still family practicality. And I think this car does a masterful job of that. It always has. And this one does well too. Now, one interesting thing, I read a lot of reviews of cars, and some of the reviews of this car talk about how it's kind of sanitized and it's not a car you fall in love with. There's not as much emotion or character here. And I think that is true, especially compared to some of the hot hatchback rivals, the Focus RS, the Civic Type R. Those are cars you can kind of fall for. The manual transmissions, the love it or hate it styling, there's a little more character. And I know a bunch of people who have had Golf R's and they never replaced it with another Golf R. They never like spent their weekend pining on their Golf R like people do with their Mustangs or their Raptors or whatever. Like, it doesn't inspire as much of an emotional reaction. But I think that that's really the point of this car. It does what it needs to. It brings performance car people into adulthood. Hey, you can't have that Mustang anymore. Now you got a kid. Now you have a real job. You can't show up in an SRT4. Well, here's a car that can do that. And it does it well. And I'm impressed with it. I'm still impressed with it. I think the interior and the quality could be a little better, but from a pure driving perspective and from an overall perspective, this is still, in my opinion, the best overall hot hatchback.
And so that's the new Volkswagen Golf R, an improvement over the old one. Not a huge change, but then the Golf R didn't really need one. It was already good, and this is better. And now it's time to give the new Golf R a DOUGSCORE.
And the DOUGSCORE is here, 63 out of 100, which places the Golf R here against other high-performance hatchbacks. It's at the top, but the score is exactly the same as the outgoing model, though there are a few differences. Specifically, the new Golf R gets a higher weekend score as it's more fun and engaging than the old one, but it gets a lower quality score as the interior has been cheapened a bit even compared to the old one. I do prefer the new Golf R to the old model. It's more fun to drive, faster, and more exciting. The lone drawback is really the interior. I personally don't mind the capacitive touch buttons as much as everyone else, but the quality could use an improvement, especially since that's historically been a main benefit of the Golf R over hot hatchback rivals that seemed cheaper.